Today we will talk about amino acids. Before that, we need to understand the role of amino acids. We know that there are four major biomacromolecules existing in biological systems. They are proteins, nucleic acids, lipids, and carbohydrates. So among these four, proteins are most important, they are most abundantly found in biological systems. And these proteins, they are nothing but they are a polymer of amino acids, where amino acids, two consecutive amino acids come together and forms a specific bond, a specific covalent bond, which is called a peptide bond. So basically, proteins are also known as polypeptides. The sequence of a protein is fixed, it is very specific, and the number of amino acids in a protein is also specific. And the sequence of amino acid in a protein, it determines function of that protein. So in order to change function of a protein, amino acid sequence of the protein can be altered. So all the proteins existing in nature, they are polypeptides. It means you have amino acids joined through peptide bonds, and the number of amino acids varies from protein to protein. For example, the smallest protein is insulin, where you have 51 amino acids, and the largest protein is titin, a human cardiac muscle protein, which has more than 26,000 amino acids, and molecular weight of titin is roughly 3 million dalton. So these all proteins, they have amino acids joined through peptide bonds. And if we talk about definition, conventionally any polypeptide where you have more than 50 amino acid, it's conventionally called protein. If you have a protein less than 50 amino acid, you generally call it a polypeptide. For example, when you have two amino acids joined together through peptide bond, it's a dipeptide, or when you have three amino acids, it's a tripeptide, and so on. So that's how the amino acids come together, form oligopeptides, and finally polypeptides. So that's why we say all proteins are polypeptide in nature, but all polypeptides you do not call protein until they are at least 51 amino acids forming that polypeptide. And that's why by definition insulin is known as the smallest protein, and titin from human cardiac muscle is the largest protein known. Similarly, proteins are most abundant in nature. Rubisco is a protein which is involved in photosynthesis, which is most abundant among all biomolecules found in nature. So from central dogma, we understand that proteins are synthesized by ribosome, and they are decoded from messenger RNA sequence. Messenger RNA in turn is transcribed from DNA. That's what we call gene. So gene means it's a fragment of DNA which encode for a RNA. It may be messenger RNA, transfer RNA, or any other kind of ribosomal RNA, for example. Then if it's a messenger RNA which is encoded from a gene sequence, DNA sequence, it gets converted into protein sequence, what you call the translation process. So just we are going to look at the mass change when proteins are synthesized from a gene. So we know that DNA is a duplex. There are two strands from 5 to 3 prime and 3 to 5 prime. And they are, that's why we call them base pairs. Those base pairs, in case of when transcription occurs, DNA duplex get uncoiled. Both the strands become separated. And one of the strand from 5 to 3 prime end is converted into protein. So just look at the mass of those nucleotides and the synthesized protein, how the mass difference occurs. So in course of duplex DNA, you have three consecutive nucleotides, what you call them codon. So one codon, or three triplets, what you call codon, at the mass of triplet, one base pair of DNA, or one base, one nucleotide of DNA has an average mass of 330 dalton. It means when you talk about base pair, when you have two strand in duplex, the mass of one base pair will be 660 dalton. So you need to remember a few numbers here. Similarly, in case of RNA, ribonucleotide, the mass is average mass of a nucleotide, ribonucleotide, 340 dalton. And when protein are synthesized in translation process, one triplet of DNA get converted into one amino acid. This we know from Seattle dogma. So it means 660 Dalton is one base pair mass. So one codon will be 3 into 660. It means 980. So 980 Dalton of DNA get converted into one amino acid after translation. And average mass of an amino acid in protein is 110 Dalton. It means 110 Dalton mass in protein is converted from 1980 mass of DNA. So if you compare mass of gene and the product protein, you will find that the mass of DNA, the gene, is almost 19 to 20 times of the protein produced after translation process. So proteins are, we know that proteins are polymer of amino acids. Amino acid sequence make a protein structure. So if we talk about, say, 100 amino acid long protein, and there are 20 amino acids only in nature, so what number of permutation combination can be formed? So that formula is, because we have 20 amino acids, and if you talk about 100 amino acid long polypeptide, each position can be replaced by either of the 20 amino acids. In that way, the total number of protein sequences which can be produced will be 20 raised to the power n. So here, if you talk about, say, 100 amino acid long protein, so 20 raised to the power 100 number of sequences. It simply means that 20 amino acids are more than sufficient to produce all possible permutations, all possible sequences of the protein which are existing in nature and which are even not existing at this time. So, for example, if you take this 20 raised to the power 100, it means if you calculate this mass of this sequence, considering average molecular weight of 110 Dalton of amino acid, this mass will be around 10 to raised to the power 134 Dalton. And if you think of the mass of the universe, which can be calculated, universe 10 to the power 80 Dalton only. It means whole universe cannot provide that mass to synthesize just 100 amino acid long protein. And if you just use 20 amino acid, all the permutations of amino acids. And we know that in nature, proteins are not 100 amino acid. In fact, the smallest protein, say 51 amino acid, and highest more than 26,000. Say all ranges of amino acids are present, all ranges of size of the proteins are present. So in that way, 20 amino acids are more than sufficient to synthesize all possible proteins existing in nature, and even which may in future which may required by the biological systems. In nature, there are 20 amino acids, and those 20 amino acids they have a common structure as well as some different groups. So each amino acid has a carbon atom which is called alpha carbon. This alpha carbon is connected to a carboxylic group, CH group, in one side. Other side, it has an amino group. That's why the name amino acid comes. And this carbon is also attached to hydrogen atom, one side. Another side, there is a R group. This R group is different in case of different amino acids because they are different. They are 20, naturally there are 20 different types of R groups are present. That's why there are 20 different amino acids exist in nature. And these 20 amino acids, they form polymer. Polymer when you talk about proteins. So proteins are made up by on these 20 amino acid sequences. Okay, so if you look at the structure, you see that the alpha carbon is having four valencies satisfied by four different groups. So this is called chiral center. So when you have a compound existing having a chiral center, it may exist in two stereoisomeric forms, and the number of stereoisomer would depend on 2 raised to the power n, where n is number of carbon chiral carbon centers. So every amino acid except glycine has at least one chiral carbon atom. It means it can exist in two stereoisomeric forms. As amino acids have chiral carbon atom, so they exist in stereoisomeric forms, and they have capability to rotate plane of the polarized light to the left hand side or right hand side. So this structure is denoted as per the Fischer, where absolute configuration of an amino acid is dictated by a rule given by Fischer, which is compared by structure of a glyceraldehyde. So in case of glyceraldehyde, if you look at this, CH2OH, CHOH, CHO, it also has one chiral carbon atom. So as a result of having this chiral carbon center, glyceraldehyde can exist in two stereoisomeric forms. One where the hydroxyl group at chiral carbon center is on the left hand side. This is called L-glyceraldehyde. Similarly, if this functional group on chiral carbon is on the right hand side, this is called D-glyceraldehyde. So amino acid structure resembling to these two states of glyceraldehyde, they are denoted with D or L. So for example, in amino acid, the R group and COH group, they are projecting behind the plane, and amino group and hydrogen, they are coming out of the plane. So in this configuration, if amino group is present on the left hand side, you call it L amino acid. Similarly, if amino group is on the right hand side, you call it T amino acid. In nature, all 20 amino acids, they exist in L forms. D forms is not found. If you synthesize in laboratory, you will get racemic mixture, you get mixture of D and L. Both isoforms exist together. But in nature, mostly you have L amino acids. The structure of amino acids are written as absolute configuration described by Fischer. So as per the convention, COH group and R group are vertically connected. You can see vertical bonds with the chiral carbon atom. So this vertical bond means these two groups, they are going below the plane. If you consider this board as a plane of chiral carbon atom, so COH group and R group, they are going behind the plane, that is shown by vertical lines. And similarly, horizontal lines where amino group and hydrogen atom are connected, horizontal line means is projecting outside the plane, is coming out of the plane. That's what you call absolute configuration. So all the amino acids in nature, they exist in L isomeric form. And these two images, these are mirror images, L and D form, they are mirror images of each other, which are not superimposable. So these are also known as enantiomers. So D and L forms are enantiomers of amino acids. And now the question is, why you have always L amino acid existing in nature? Because if you synthesize amino acid, you get racemic mixture of L and D both together. But in biological system, amino acids are synthesized by enzymes. So those enzymes are stereoselective. They can only produce L form of the amino acids. That's why in nature, mostly you have L amino acid existing. But in some cases, you have D amino acid also. For example, in case of bacterial cell wall, peptidoglycan, you have some D form of amino acids also. So when you have D amino acid, because enzymes which hydrolyze amino acids, they are also stereoselective, they are also enantioselective. So they can even proteases, peptidases, they can only hydrolyze peptide bond which is formed by L form of amino acid. So if any peptide bond is formed between D amino acid, proteases will not act. So in case of bacteria, peptidoglycan become resistant to proteolytic cleavage because of presence of those D amino acids.